Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the October 12th, 2017, St. Mary's County Board of Appeals hearing. There's sign-in sheets outside the door if you're speaking this evening. Also, there's one for people attending tonight in case further information needs to be sent to you regarding any of our cases. We'll start with the introduction of our board to my left.
Stuart Egley, alternate.
Wayne Medinsky.
John Brown.
George Allen Hayden.
Sandy Green, recording secretary.
Ronald Payne.
William Green.
David Weisskopf, office of law.
Yvonne Chalet, zoning administrator.
And for the record, we have William Hunt, the director of land use and growth management in the audience, and Bob Bowles, planner for land use and growth management as well. We have two hearings tonight. We have a continuation of the Woods and Myrtle Point, but we also have a variance request, a critical area variance request. And we believe that that will probably be a little bit shorter, so I'm going to switch it up a little bit. We're going to do the critical area variance case first, and then we'll get back into the Woods and Myrtle Point. So, Ms. Chalet, were certified mail and receipts, do we get those for the
Swan property?
Yep, I'm sorry. Our case is, let me just announce the case, please. The VAAP 17-1088, the Swan property. And yes, ma'am, the Swan property.
Yes, we did receive the certified mail receipts, the proof of that from the enterprise, and the certification of property posting in the mailing receipts. And that is staff exhibit one, and that was submitted to the recording secretary prior to the hearing.
Okay, so we'll get you a legal description and presentation, but first, can you be sworn in, please? Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you.
The applicants are requesting a variance from section 71.8.3 of the Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance to replace an existing single-family dwelling in the critical area buffer. The property owners are Anthony and Jean Swan. Their agent is Wayne Hunt, who is a professional land surveyor with Little Silences Rest, or LSR. The property is located at 25000 Twin Oaks Way in Hollywood on tax map 27, grid 5, parcel 281 in the 6th election district. The property is 38,514 square feet in size, which is just under an acre at 0.88 acres. The property is zoned Rural Preservation District with a critical area designation of limited development area. The property and the variance request were advertised in the enterprise on September 27th and October 4th, 2017. The agenda was posted last week on October 5th, 2017. And would you like me to present the staff report?
Please.
The subject property is a grandfathered lot in a critical area because it was recorded prior to the adoption of the critical area regulations by the state on December 1st, 1985. The property was recorded in the land records of St. Mary's County. The property fronts Cuckold Creek, so it is constrained by the minimum 100-foot critical area buffer. The buffer has been expanded to include steep slopes. The existing soil types on the property are not highly erodible soils, nor are they hydric soils, and those soil types are matapeaks and matapeaks silt loam. According to the site plan provided by LSR and as shown in the table listed in the staff report, the existing lot coverage on the property is 4,493 square feet. The applicant will be removing 1,447 square feet, leaving 3,046 square feet. The applicant proposes a total of 1,762 square feet of new lot coverage. So following construction, that lot coverage amount will be 4,808 square feet. The allowed lot coverage on this property is 15% of the property, which is 5,777 square feet. The existing lot coverage that is in the critical area buffer, which is included in the 4,493 square feet, is 2,453 square feet. The applicant will be removing just a little over 1,200 square feet and proposing 1,179 square feet for a total of 2,386 square feet of lot coverage in the critical area buffer. This is a net decrease in what is currently there of 67 square feet. The shoreline of the property is within a special flood hazard zone. However, the development will be outside the floodplain. The existing woodland or vegetative cover on the property is approximately 82% of the property. The applicants plan to clear about 1,500 square feet, which is 3.9% of the existing vegetation. The applicant will be required to mitigate at a ratio of 3-to-1 per square foot of the variance granted, and at a ratio of 1-to-1 for the area of temporary disturbance. The Health Department has approved the site plan, and the Soil Conservation District has also approved the site plan. Stormwater management is not required because the applicant will be disturbing less than 5,000 square feet. The Critical Area Commission provided comments. The Critical Area Commission is not opposed to the variance. They have a concern with the proposed deck because the deck, once it is attached to the house, will be closer to the water than the existing house that is on the property. And that concludes my staff report. Under each of the standards for granting a variance in the critical area, staff has noted what staff believes the Board of Appeals has to determine in order to find that the applicant has complied with each of the standards. So I would like to submit my staff report and the attachments as Exhibit 2.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Shalay.
You're welcome.
Any questions for Ms. Shalay?
No.
Mr. Hunt?
I'm going to present over here if you don't mind.
That'll be fine. For the record, if you would, your name and address, please.
My name is Wayne Hunt. I'm a professional land surveyor with Little Silences Rest. I live in Mechanicsville, Maryland, 29807 Clare Circle.
And we'll get you sworn in before you get started, please. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and the statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
All right, I have before you an application for an appeal to replace a dwelling in the critical areas. Some basic site information going over this once again. It's about a little less than an acre, 0.884 acres, RPD zoning, LDA critical area overlay, proposed use, dwelling unit detached, single family. One of the items here that was not mentioned previously is that I don't know if you noticed on the site plan that was provided to you, but part of the proposed building appears to be over the building restriction line. And that has actually been taken care of. We have made an application with the adjoining property owner for a reduction in side yard, and that has been signed, submitted. I'm not sure if it has been recorded of this date, but it has been taken care of. The site located in Hollywood, Maryland, you can see here. It's the end of Twin Oaks Way, off the end of Smith Nursery Road. Blow up here shows a little bit more detail where the site is located. At the bottom here, that little portion right there is Twin Oaks Way, the private driveway. This is a picture at the end of Smith Nursery Road, the end of the private right-of-way. You can see the end of County Road maintenance sign there to just show that we posted a sign on the public right-of-way, not required above and beyond, but we felt that was the right thing to do. And this is a picture of the sign as it enters the property, and this is the driveway shown here as it enters the property. This first picture here is taken facing the front of the house. It's actually looking over the septic system towards the house. If I go through this too fast, don't hesitate to tell me to slow down. This is a little bit closer, showing the front of the house in a little bit more detail. This is the same spot looking right, going in reverse of the private driveway, Quinnox Way. So this is leading away from the site. And this is facing the other way, just showing you what one of the wood sheds looks like that's out front. This is a little bit closer view of the front of the house and what we're dealing with here. You can see this is definitely a modest size existing home. This view is from the right or left front corner of the house as you're facing it, looking north, and it shows the woodshed that's close to the edge of the property down there. You can see in the ravine. This is a view of the rear of the home that is going to be replaced, and you can see there is a small porch or stoop in the area where we're proposing a deck already.
Mr. Hunt, and you call them the rear of the house is what faces the water?
This is the side that faces the water, yes, sir. This is looking the other direction. This is the view outside the back of the house towards the water. And finally, just a picture of the pier that's on the back of the property. All right, this is a copy of the site plan that was provided for your review as part of this application. And this is a slight blow up that might help with discussions as we move forward. At this point, I'd like to go ahead and present to you my reasons for consideration for the appeal. The first item that we must address is that special conditions or circumstances which exist and are peculiar to the land or structure involved exist, and that strict enforcement of the critical area provisions of this ordinance would result in unwanted hardship. The parcel contains, like it says, 38,514 square feet. Within 51% of that is in the expanded critical area buffer, so over half of it has been lost to the buffer. The location of the proposed house is also constrained by setback requirements from the existing well, and impervious surfaces to be removed in the buffer is 1,246 square feet, with 1,179 square feet proposed, making a reduction of 67 square feet. Basically, there's not much other room for us to put the house or any other kind of improvements. If we are to strictly enforce the critical area regulations, they will not be allowed to build. And that goes into our next one. The strict interpretation of the critical area provisions of this ordinance will deprive the applicant of rights commonly enjoyed by other properties, which this will do. And the original conveyance of this property, as noted before, was before the adoption of the critical area regulations. Next item is granting of the variance will not confer upon an applicant any special privileges that would not be denied by the critical area provisions of this ordinance to other lands or other structures within the critical area of St. Mary's County. Now, this property is a recorded lot in an existing community constrained by zoning, health requirements, and the critical area provisions. Other property owners under similar circumstances would have the opportunity to file for a variance and seek relief from the requirements. The variance is not based upon conditions or circumstances that are the result of actions by the applicant. This request for a variance is the result of the adoption of the critical area regulations after the recording of this lot, and not as a result of actions by the applicant. Next, in item E, the granting of a variance will not adversely affect water quality or adversely impact fish, wildlife, or plant habitat within the critical area. My response to this, which I believe is part of your package, needs to be slightly amended. It reads, the limit of disturbance has been minimized as much as possible and stormwater management has been provided to improve water quality and prevent erosion. That should be amended to say in accordance with current regulations. Stormwater management has not been provided with this plan, but it's not required by current regulations. Sediment erosion control will be provided in accordance with St. Mary's County soil conservation requirements as well. A planting agreement will be required, and the applicant understands that. And this variance is the minimum necessary to achieve a reasonable use of land or structure. Now, this plan is asking for a 1,600-square-foot house. I've done other plans where they've asked to replace a 1,600-square-foot house because it wasn't large enough. So I think this request is very reasonable. They're also reducing impervious surfaces in the buffer. They're not going through with this plan and trying to pave every square inch in the buffer or on the lot that some other people have been trying to do. They're looking for a reasonable use of the property, not an extreme use of the property. All of this is in keeping with the spirit of the ordinance. In regards to the State Critical Area Commission comments, they have a problem with the, first off, with the plantings. They say that the plantings were done incorrectly, but regardless of how they were done, you will notice on your plan under plantings provided, we're saying plantings required 4,893. In their comments, they're asking for 4,893 square feet of plantings. So regardless of how we got there, we came up with the same number. And we're going to provide the amount of plantings. Actually, we're in excess of the amount of plantings required. We're planting 5,100 square feet for mitigation. So they may have a point about how the comments or how the calculations were done, but we do have the same number. And finally, we are proposing a deck that is 78 feet closer than the existing deck. But you look at the plan, it is a moderately sized deck. It is not a huge deck. Let me go back. Which is right there in the blue, that area right there. It doesn't, you know, follow the whole end of the house. And a deck is something that people in the neighborhood or who own property in the critical areas commonly enjoy. So they're not asking for something that is not commonly enjoyed by other people in the critical area. The owners, Mr. and Mrs. Swan, are here. They have signed up as speaking, but they would rather not speak unless they have to. So if you have any questions of them, they are available. Okay. And I believe that ends my presentation, and I'm ready for questions.
Okay. Anyone have any?
Okay. Mr. Hunt, the current house, when was that built?
Oh, goodness, that's an old one. That's going to be the Swans. I'm going to have to ask them. Do you want them to?
Well, at least get one of them sworn in. Okay.
Mr. Swan? Please. We're going to need you to testify, please.
He can either stand or sit, just in case we have more questions. Okay. Before we get started, I'd like, for the record, if you would give us your name and address.
Anthony Thomas Swan, Jr., 10911 Tyrone Drive, Upper Baldwin, Maryland.
Okay. And before you give your answers, do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, response, and statement you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. And the question again, Mr. Payne?
When was this, the current house, when was that built?
It was started in 1957. To my knowledge, it was my uncle's house. We purchased it from the estate.
Mr. Swan, I need you to speak into that microphone just so we can pick you up on record, please.
Fine. It was, we purchased the house through the estate. It was my uncle's house, and I believe it was built in 1957.
Okay, so in essence, you just want to replace an older home with a newer one.
That is correct. Yes, sir.
Okay. That's all the questions I have.
Anyone else have any questions?
Oh, sure. What's the deck going to be constructed of?
The deck is going to be required.
I need you to speak into the mic, please. Thank you.
The deck is going to be required to have 3/8-inch minimum gaps between the boards to comply with the impervious requirements for a deck. As far as the construction of the deck itself, I'm not sure if it's going to be wood or composite.
To be determined by the builder.
But it will be something similar to that, either wood or composite.
What's actually being removed? I don't know if you want, you know. Wayne could probably take care of you, Mr. Hunt.
How much detail do you want?
I'd like to know what's being removed. I see one thing where it points to some of the sidewalk, but I didn't know how much of that was being removed.
If you can maybe blow this up a little bit and use your pointer, to your mouse to show the board what's being removed.
This is blown up a little bit, but... you see this sidewalk here,
yes,
where it ties in at the end, and the sidewalk there where it ties in at the end.
Right.
I believe all that sidewalk right there is going to be removed. Appears as though all the sidewalk between the front and the back is going to be removed.
All of it that's in black?
All of it right there, yes. 302 square feet of sidewalk to be removed in the buffer and 87 out of the buffer.
Well, that's part of it. What else?
The existing home right here is to be removed, is impervious. And the stoop that goes along with it, which is right there in the back, that's the stoop area right there, is to be removed. So stoop, house, and walk are the only things being removed.
Okay. Okay. I'm good.
Anyone else? Thank you. Thank you, sir. All right. We'll open it up to public testimony. Anyone wishing to speak this evening in this case? Seeing none, we'll close public testimony. Anything else, Mr. Hunt?
No, sir.
You good? Okay. Any comments? Any discussion here?
Normally, I'm real concerned when critical area has a problem, but after seeing the photo and how level the side of the house towards the water, it's doesn't look like they're going to disturb more than a couple of posts. Probably should put something about the spacing. I don't know if we have to do that or not.
I don't think we have to do that, do we, Ms. Chalet?
No, staff puts that on the permit.
We had those questions before.
But that was the only problem I had. Right. And after seeing the photo, I don't have any problems at all.
Okay. Anybody else have any comments? Yeah, I'm like Mr. Modesky. It's actually, they put it back less than what they're taking out. It's very modest, and I, you know, house that old, I can understand why they would like to replace it with a little bit more of a modern living spaces. So I don't have any issues with this request this evening. So if no one else has any other comments, then I'll be open for a motion.
I guess I'll be the reader. In the matter of BAAP 17-1088 Swan Property, having made a finding that the standards for granting a variance in the critical area and the objectives of sections 71.8.3 of the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance have been met, I move to approve the variance request to disturb the critical area buffer to construct a replacement single-family dwelling.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Mr. Green?
Yes.
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 Yes. Okay. The Mr. Hunt, you can see the board has voted unanimously to support your applicant's request this evening. An order reflecting the board's decision will be prepared by staff and signed by the board within 30 days. A 30-day period follows from the date the order is signed, during which any aggrieved party may appeal the board's decision in circuit court. And any action taken during the time will be at your own risk, and we'll mail you a copy of the order once it's signed. Okay?
I understand, and thank you.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
The pictures really helped.
They do.
That was good. That was good. Thank you.
We'll give the board a couple of minutes to get your papers up and get them straight. The case we're going to hear now is the Woods at Myrtle Point, the concept site plan.
16132-002. This would be a continuation of the when we started the case last month. And just to get everyone up to date, we left off with, we were in the middle of public testimony. So we'll go back to the public testimony and we'll get started there. We had sign-in sheets last month, and the people that spoke, we've recorded their names and stuff. So if they've signed in again tonight, they will not be called. Only you're allowed to come up one time, and that was, if you spoke last month, you're not going to speak this month, okay? I just want to make myself clear. Anyone that hasn't spoken that did sign up tonight will be allowed to speak this evening, okay? Everybody straight? Okay. All right. Let's get the PowerPoint out of the way. What's the gentleman's lady's name? Money, Kaisan, and Delaney. I think you have a PowerPoint. We'll get the PowerPoint done first, and then we'll move into additional public testimony.
Can we get the presentation from here so we can see the monitor?
Yes. Will you both be testifying this evening?
We will.
Then, okay. Okay, if you would please. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony and response to the statement you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
And if you would, for the record, your name and address. But you need to sit down so we can mic and pick you up, please.
Julie Delaney, 45549 Deer Crossing Lane, California, Maryland.
Okay.
Walter Manakaisen, 45549 Deer Crossing Lane, California.
Okay. Now, is this the PowerPoint just from the two of you that are giving testimony here tonight, or?
It represents the surrounding communities along Myrtle Point Road and Deer Crossing Lane. It represents concerns of more than just the two of us.
Did he give the updated decorous?
Maybe I'll check.
Julie and I will give a joint briefing.
Just a second. I'm not sure that, unless it's a standard group, Mr. Weisskopf, help me up, clear this up a little bit. Are these folks allowed to speak for other folks in the audience if it's not from a community group or a community?
Well, I'm sure other people in the audience could cede their time to them if that's what they want to do.
Okay.
Are there other people here that you're speaking for? Is the question you have?
I think it's my question, yes. I just want to make sure that we're not speaking for folks that don't want to be spoken for.
Gotcha.
Yeah, this thing has been going on so long, people have come to a lot of these, so some people have fallen off.
Understood, but I don't want something presented to the board tonight that not everyone's in agreement with.
Can those in the room who would like to concede their time to us, would they please raise their hand?
So we're going to need names of that. If that's the case, they don't speak tonight. Is that how it goes?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the ones that are raising the hands that are going to be satisfied with the PowerPoint that's going to be presented this evening, that's going to be part of your speaking time, okay, given to these folks. Okay? So I will need your name so we can take it off the list for speaking this evening. So the ones that raised the hand, if you would just come to the mic and give us your name.
Yes, my name is Greg Shields. 4141 Mill Cove Road, California, Maryland.
Okay.
Okay.
I did not sign up to speak, but I would like them to represent me as well. It's Deborah Shields, 24141 Mill Cove Road, California.
Okay.
I'm not on the list either, but we'd like for them to speak for us. Paul J. Manchak, 23678 Myrtle Point Road.
Can you spell your last name for us, please?
M-A-N-C-H-A-K.
Okay, great, thanks. Anyone else? Okay. Is there anyone that really doesn't want them speaking for you? Okay. Mr. Longmore, they gave us an updated presentation this evening. Have you gotten that updated presentation?
No,
do you have one of these you can give to Mr. Longmore, please? Okay.
Julie and I will give a joint briefing this evening. You have hard copies of the slides, and we have attached copies of the exhibits that we'll reference at the end of your PowerPoint presentation. Our first purpose this evening is to express our concerns with the proposed development. Specifically, we object to the townhouses replacing single-family homes. And most important, we object to the developer's plan to increase the number of units in sections 5 and 6 from the already approved 31 units to 110 units. The increase proposed to be achieved through the use of TDRs is just too much. We are not objecting to the pool clubhouse in section 4 or the condos in section 2. We include recommendations at the end of our presentation that will reduce our concerns. Next slide. We have three broad areas of concern. The first is the impact to the surrounding neighborhood. The second addresses traffic concerns. And the third is water and sewer connections.
Starting off with the impact to the neighborhood, sections 5 and 6 are currently approved for a total of 31 single-family homes, and the developer is now proposing to increase units to 110 townhouses. Section 6 is currently zoned RLT, as is the surrounding neighborhood. The proposed increase in density and the increase from single-family homes to townhomes would substantially change the character of the surrounding neighborhood. The proposed townhouses in Section 6 also exceed the allowable density for RLT. During our initial review of the published data, we discovered that it was difficult to determine how the proposed Section 5 and 6 compared with the currently approved Section 5 and 6. The graphic at the left is the current approved site plan provided by the county at our request. It has a total of 31 single-family homes spread across Section 5 and 6. The graphic at the right shows the proposed 110 townhouses. This side-by-side comparison illustrates the extent of the proposed density increase. This is an aerial view with the overlay of the proposed 110 townhomes. As you can see, this increase in density significantly changes the character of the surrounding neighborhood. We took the following pictures to capture the character of the We took the following pictures to capture the character of the surrounding RLT neighborhoods. The first set of pictures are from the Deer Crossing Lane community. It's a rural waterfront community with single-family homes. It's zoned RLT. It has single-family homes on large lots with lots of woods and open space. It's served by a private road. As you can see, the 24 townhouses in Section 6 would substantially change the character of Deer Crossing Lane community. The second set of pictures are from the Myrtle Point Road community. It's also a rural community with single-family homes. It's also zoned RLT. It also has single-family homes on large lots, and it's served by a rural county road. As you can also see, the proposed 24 townhouses in Section 6 would also substantially change the character of Myrtle Point Road.
Is this an existing site?
Yes.
That has not been built on? Is this in Section 5 or 6?
Oh, no. This is the surrounding neighborhood.
Okay, then I think you're kind of putting an apple and an orange out here, okay? Because what you're saying to me, what I understand you're saying, is this is what exists today, and if we did this, it would be an impact. Okay, can you show the impact?
Yeah, what we're really trying to allude to is the impact on the existing people who live in the community by changing the character of the community with putting such high-density townhomes.
Okay.
I'm not sure if that answers your question.
Not totally yet.
Okay.
I think we will address your concerns later on when we address the county ordinance, specifically Chapter 62.
Yeah. Okay.
Mr. Green?
Considering the other people's time as well, how much time?
I'm going to let them do their PowerPoint, because they're speaking for others as well, okay?
So is there a amount of time that's given to each person? I believe there is.
We gave 3 minutes last time.
Okay, for each person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right.
So you want to move through it pretty quickly, if you would, please. Thank you, Mr. Green. Okay.
Yeah, does that include questions?
No, the question's on me.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, next slide. Our final impact to the neighborhood concerns objections with Section 6 zoning. Site plans provided to the county by the developer show RL zoning in all sections of the development, including Section 6. The previous developer stated Section 6 zoning is RL as far back as 2005. The current developer continues to falsely define zoning for Section 6 as RL in the approved and the proposed concept site plan. The county staff report and the developer's proposed site plan did not include zoning change approval as a condition. The data was presented as if the zoning change had already occurred. Not until we pointed out the actual RLT zoning just prior to last month's meeting did they propose it as a condition. Assertions that the Lexington Park District Master Development Plan removes RLT zoning are false. Review of the plan provided in your attachments discussions with the senior planner assigned to the plan confirms this. Also, the plan's recommendation to change zoning in Myrtle Point area requires formal approval by the county.
I just objected to a point about an unnamed senior planner. I believe they have to testify based on their own knowledge, not on somebody else's. If there's another witness that wants to present, they can tonight.
Okay. Thank you.
I can look her name up and provide it.
We'll disregard that comment.
Okay.
Okay.
Also, the plan's recommendation to change zoning in the Myrtle Point area requires formal approval by the county, including public hearings. The required approval is not a foregone conclusion, as asserted by the developer's attorney. The hearings are not on the commissioner's schedule and are not expected to occur until sometime next year. The developer has requested and received approval for site plans and grading plans based on false data. The developer has moved forward with clearing trees in Section 6 based on this data. These are screenshots of the documents that I referenced. The 2005 phasing plan, this was included with the Planning Commission package for the 626, you probably have it in your files, 17 meeting. Then the 2014 approved site plan, that was provided by the county at our request. And then finally, the 2017 proposed site plan. All of these documents show the zoning in Section 6 as RL. And finally, the closing of the impact to the neighborhood. The zoning ordinance states the purpose of RLT zoning is to protect community character and provide for low-density development. The allowable base density is 1 unit per acre. A developer can propose an increase to density with TDRs, but But for RLT, the current maximum is 3 units per acre. Therefore, they are proposing 9 units over the allowable density.
Traffic is our next area of concern. The developer is proposing 110 townhouses to have direct access to Myrtle Point Road. Myrtle Point Road is a narrow, twisting road with no shoulder. It's ill-suited to support the proposed level of service for 110 units. The proposed development would exasperate an already failing Pax Boulevard and Route 4 intersection. This intersection is failing now and would get only worse with proposed development. The county's ordinance is clear. A minimum of a D is required, and this intersection is an F, according to DPWNT. The county's ordinance also requires mitigation, yet none is proposed, according to the written DPWNT report. Yet mitigation is simple. Don't approve TDRs to compound a failing intersection. You have a copy of the ordinance, that Article 7, in your package, and you have the DPW report marked as Attachment 5 in your package. The developer submitted a 2017 traffic impact analysis, which used a 2007 TIA as a baseline. The 2007 TIA only addressed sections 2 and 3 of the development, with both of those sections only accessing Patuxent Boulevard. The new proposed development includes sections 4, 5, and 6. The latter two sections provide 110 units with direct access to Myrtle Point Road. The 2017 TIA failed to consider the new egress and ingress points. The county's ordinance, Article 7, Section 70.7.2, you have a copy of it in your package, requires the TIA to address service levels of the first intersections in all directions. This requires that the Myrtle Point Kingston Creek Road intersection, as well as the Patuxent Road Route 4 intersection, be addressed. It was not addressed in the 2017 TIA. The Myrtle Point Kingston Creek intersection is already awkward. The dip and turn in the road right after the intersection makes it difficult. The church entrance immediately following and the Route 4 intersection also immediately following make it ill-suited to more traffic. Already evening southbound Route 4 traffic uses the intersection to shorten the backup from the light at Pax Boulevard and Route 4. Morning and evening northbound traffic on Kingston Creek Road uses Myrtle Point Road because they can't make a left turn on the Route 4 because of the traffic. The proposed development will just make this worse. The county's ordinance also requires the effect of other developments to be considered. Again, it's in the package that we gave you what the ordinance says. None of additional developments were considered and submitted as part of the 2017 TIA.
And finally, our final concern with the 2017 TIA, the developer has quantified the traffic impact by using a standard trip generation rate for townhouses, while proposing upscale townhouses that are anything but standard. Expansive floor plans, oversized garage, additional parking spaces have been requested, in fact, 102 of them. This is a significant increase over the maximum allowed for townhouses. All of this indicates a larger than standard number of vehicles per townhouse. Wouldn't a project-specific rate be more appropriate? The zoning ordinance allows for that. The traffic engineer testified that the 2017 TIA was an informal analysis. How can an informal analysis based on a much earlier analysis be adequate for an APF assessment? A more detailed study was needed in 2007. Why not now?
Our final area of concern is with water and sewer. Section 6 is outside the county's comprehensive water and sewer plan service area. Neither the Department of Health nor METCOM approved the proposed Section 6 plan. You have copies of both, attachment 2 and 3 of the Department of Health and MetCom in your package. This is a glaring deficiency.
As promised, we have recommendations for the board to consider. Number one, don't make a failing intersection worse by increasing the number of units previously approved. Number two, maintain the concept site plan for single-family homes in Section 6. Number three, modify Section 5 access locations. Put both access locations on Patuxent Boulevard. As the pictures show, Patuxent Boulevard is better equipped to handle the increased traffic. And finally, number four, increase the buffer in Section 5 along Myrtle Point Road. Eliminating Section 5 access to Myrtle Point Road and moving the second access location to Patuxent Boulevard allows for a more appropriate buffer between the proposed townhouses in Section 5 and the surrounding RLT community. This is a graphical representation of recommendations 3 and 4. We recommend eliminating Section 5 access to Myrtle Point Road by adding a second access point on Patuxent Boulevard. Alternative locations are shown on the slide. As you can see, the developer's proposed layout provides significantly more buffer surrounding the developer's single-family houses and less buffer to the Myrtle Point neighborhood zoned RLT. Show the existing RLT neighborhood the same respect and provide more buffer to them.
In summary, the board needs to make 6 determinations for approval. I've highlighted each of the 6 areas and we'll walk through each one. Item 1 addresses consistency with a comprehensive plan. The proposed development is not consistent. Section 6 is not zoned for the proposed density. Section 6 is outside the county's water and sewer plan service area. The second determination addresses adequate public facilities. The ordinance requires adequacy determination for preliminary subdivision approval, and Article 770.2 does not use the term may or might. It clearly states that APF determination must be made before a preliminary plan is approved. There is no second chance on this, and Mr. Hunt can confirm this. Your approval tonight is all that's required for them to proceed. A compliant TIA has not been done. The Patuxent Boulevard and Route 4 intersection does not meet the county ordinance defined minimum standard.
We're down to 1 minute. Okay.
Section 6 is outside the water and sewer service plan. Item 3 requires the board to confirm consistency with growth plan. We don't have advice there. Item 4 is very broadly stating, requiring the board to certify development promotes the health, safety, and welfare of the public. The word promotes sets a higher bar than saying something is neutral or has a minimum effect. Townhouses in Section 6 detract from the surrounding neighborhood. 110 units directly accessing Myrtle Point is a safety issue, especially considering an obvious alternative. Item 5 deals with recreation. We leave that to your determination. Item 6 is the final determination required by the board. It addresses compliance with the county's extensive description of design objectives described in 62, and we've included them there. The ordinance is clear that any proposed development must be evaluated not as a standalone island, but instead be seen from the perspective of how it fits with the surrounding area. Townhouses in Section 6 do not conform with the surrounding neighborhood. An increased buffer in Section 5 would help. The bottom line, the proposed plan does not meet the requirements for approval. 4 of the 6 criteria are not satisfied, and these are not areas where conditional approval is appropriate. Tell the developer to go back to the Planning Commission when they have a compliant plan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions from the board?
Not right now.
Thank you.
Sure.
Allison Swift. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And for the record, your name and address, please.
Allison Swift. I reside at 45136 Woodhaven Drive in California, Maryland. Okay. Thank you for allowing me to speak. I just wanted to say that I'm extremely concerned that my property value will be adversely affected by adding the condominiums to the Woods at Myrtle Point development. And therefore, I do not support this proposal. Originally, the single-family homes were to make up 62% of this community, with the rest, 38%, being townhomes. While the overall number of residences were unchanged, the revised plan approved in 2014 decreased the amount of single-family homes to 45% of this community. If this proposal is approved, the percentage of single-family homes is reduced even further to only 32%. Once this development is complete, this proposed change would mean the residents with the highest investments have minimal amount of influence regarding the homeowners association and preservation of our beautiful neighborhood. Therefore, I respectfully request that this board denies the proposal and encourage the developer to uphold a more equitable distribution of single family homes and townhomes. Thank you very much for your time, and any time I have left, I concede to Valerie Walter.
Okay, thank you. Anyone have any questions?
No.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Valerie Walter. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimonies, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
And for the record, your name and address, please.
Valerie Walter, 45151 Woodhaven Drive, California.
Okay, I need you to speak a little bit louder, please.
Valerie Walter.
Thank you.
45151 Woodhaven Drive, California, Maryland.
Okay. I need you to speak into the microphone, okay? Because it, please. Thank you.
I want to start by saying that I do not agree with the current planned proposal by Curtis Homes for our development. When I'm one of the first homeowners in the neighborhood, and when I moved in 10 years ago, I had purchased into a plan that was part of a community that was the majority single-family homes. Townhomes would be a much smaller makeup of our neighborhood. When obviously, our original developer is gone and Curtis Homes came in. When they did so, they promised to uphold that vision that we were promised. And now, in this new plan, we don't believe that's being maintained. So I have the following information I'd like to present to refute this new plan. I don't believe that their study for the demographic of buyers in St. Mary's County supports the business venture proposed for the Woods at Myrtle Point. According to sworn testimony of Superintendent Scott Smith of St. Mary's County Schools during the fiscal year 2010 to 2024, St. Mary's County Public School State Capital Improvements Program presentation that was given to the commissioners on September 19, 2017, growth in St. Mary's County is the opposite of what has been presented by Curtis Homes. While discussing enrollment projections in their 10-year master plan, they testified that the growth will continue to be the greatest in the central portion of the county. If you look at the video that can be found on YouTube, at 47 minutes and 20 seconds, they state that over the next 6 years, there is a trend predicting a rise in secondary education because, as Mr. Smith states, while historically we had been losing students in high school from those leaving the county, that has not been true in the past 2 years. He states, and I quote, "Not in the last 2 years, because the county itself is seeing growth and seeing people stay and seeing people invest in property and some more expensive property." He went on to testify, and again, I quote him, "Homes being built are on the upper end, which is a more mature family that is moving in, not people looking for townhomes necessarily, but more expensive homes for mature families." Again, if you go to 52 minutes and 20 seconds, he states, quoting again,
The growth right now is happening in the center part of the county. It is where people are buying homes and developments, and these homes are not inexpensive. You can look all around the county, and they are $350,000 to $450,000 homes. And for a family to be able to afford a home at that cost, they have to be further along in their lives. I think it's important to talk about this makeup because the decision made here...
You're down to 30 seconds, okay?
Okay. It's going to directly impact the future of our neighborhood. Providing townhomes and condos at a lower price point while intended to promote sales of a certain demographic is not a guarantee. Townhomes and condos also can be bought by investors and serve as rental properties, which will lower the price point of our homes that we already have. Millennials... were testified as their main market, but we haven't seen that. And again, it directly contradicts what was presented by the school superintendent. So,
okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any questions? Julie Lyle. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony and response to the statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, and your names and addresses, please. And you'll both have to speak into that mic, okay?
Julie Lyle, 45480 Haven Ridge Street, California, Maryland.
Okay.
Arthur Lyle, 45480 Haven Ridge Street, California, Maryland.
Thank you.
Okay. I just want to say that I'm for the townhomes.
Okay.
I'm also for everything that's going on. Appreciate it.
All right.
Thank
you. Testoil Kassan. I know I butchered that name, but T-E-S-T-O-Y-E. And do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony and responses and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And speak into the mic, please.
I do.
Okay, and your name and address, please.
Testify Kassahun.
Can you slow down with that just a little bit so I understand?
T-E-S.
No, say it so I understand what it is. So I cannot.
Testify Kassahun.
Okay. Okay. Go ahead, sir.
I live in 45197 Woodhaven Drive. I have been there for 4 years.
Okay, great.
And I support the proposed project by Curtis Hall. I believe the study that's done 10 years ago for the traffic is still valid. So I still believe the traffic will not impact the current resident and accountability. I believe they are accountable for what they promised, and they kept the neighborhood very clean, and the atmosphere changed. I was there before Curtis Home started building that neighborhood. It was my perspective, my opinion. It wasn't that much interesting, the neighborhood. Since they moved in, I moved in also about the same time, 4 years, the neighborhood changed. On the top of that, accommodating townhouse is also a strategic interest of the county, because the proposed price for the price of the townhouse is way higher, and it is luxury, and there is no other place, I believe, in the county that can offer that. Therefore, I believe that's a good plan. On the top of that, the price of the neighborhood per square feet will increase because the townhouse space is limited, but the price is higher. Therefore, compared to the rest of the county, the square foot of that area price will increase, not decrease. And I believe my house value will increase. Therefore, I support Curtis' proposed project. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Lisa Pregolana. Pregolena. Last name? Jason Kitchan. Okay, your name was on the slate. Okay. Okay. Anyone else that didn't sign in? We'll start with you. You were supporting the PowerPoint, right?
No.
He spoke last time. What's his name?
He spoke.
Okay. He spoke. And what's your name, sir?
Robert Willie.
Mr. Willard, didn't you speak last time?
No, sir. You opened it up for questions for the traffic consultant. I did ask a question.
Huh? And you spoke then?
I asked a question.
Okay.
I didn't know that would count against my time.
Okay. We'll give you a couple minutes. How's that?
Thank you. Okay.
Let me swear you in. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony and response to the statement you may give the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And your name, sir?
Robert Willie.
The address?
23919 Mill Cove Road.
Okay.
California, Maryland.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes. During one of the last hearings, Curtis proposed substituting townhouses for single-family homes. This was sold to our neighborhood of single-family homes as a solution for all the muddy runoff into the local creeks by reducing soil disruption, impervious surfaces, fewer driveways, roads, etc. In this area of steep slopes and highly erodible, Evesboro was failure complex soil. This seemed logical. It is a challenging place to build, and development should be kept to level areas. Now the developer is coming back proposing more homes at a higher density, which would seem to run counter to the goal of reducing impervious surfaces as previously offered as the reason for the increased density. I was going to say, when John McNamara first sought approvals in the 1980s for what is now Myrtle Point, the population in St. Mary's County was about 60,000 people. It is just about double that now and growing. The census recorded an increase of population of 18,940 between 2000 and 2010. That's a population that went from 86,000 to 105,000. That's a 22% increase. Over the same period of time, Calvert County grew 19%. Over the 30-plus years since this project was approved, the traffic between 235 and 4 intersection and the Thomas Johnson Bridge has become a serious bottleneck, only to get worse, considering the development already approved in the area and yet to be built. The 140-acre Lexington Exchange has been approved for commercial development with only the movie theater and an Aldi built. Wildwood has yet to be built out. Even after 30-plus years, most of the approved homes at Woods of Myrtle Point have yet to be built. The Marketplace commercial development is under construction. FDR Boulevard is under construction with two intersections within a block of a 235-4 intersection, one across Route 4 by the tire stores and one across 235 by the Mill Road. These intersections will impede traffic flow as Wildwood and Marketplace develop, grow, and feed in traffic. Recently, a lane was added to Route 4 to move some of the traffic back up off 235. Any real improvement in the traffic situation with this area has been announced as over a decade away, and I agree with Todd Morgan that most of the people our age will never live to see a new four-lane TJ bridge or the proposed flyover on 235. In the meantime, the population of St. Mary's can be expected to grow by more than 20,000 with similar growth in Calvert County. insulating Pax River from a brack closure is often cited by the local politicians as justification for traffic improvements. But there is little the county can do in this area, and the state has done what it can on the cheap. Shelby Guasbo said in the Planning Commission meeting, when you live in a one-horse town, you take good care of that horse. Moving the community center to a central location is a good idea for the residents, but the quest for additional homes should be turned down for the sake of California residents and the rest of the county. The appeals board should uphold the Planning Commission decision. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Wiley.
Anyone else?
Yes, sir.
That's all I got.
Come on up.
Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And your name and address, sir?
Joe Van Kirk, 27090 Beachview Lane, Mechanicsville, Maryland. Here speaking as a concerned citizen. I've got quite a few points. I'll condense them unless you have questions.
Okay.
Based upon the subdivision ordinance, zoning ordinance, and the comprehensive plan, there's numerous chapters in there that states developers shall, must, will upgrade the roads, public infrastructure, to suit their needs of a subdivision. I know in the subdivision ordinance it says that mitigation can be provided. They're getting 84 more homes just on this plan, not counting what they got in 2013 or 14, at say $325,000 apiece, $27 million, and given the count of $15,000. It's laughable, really. As far as, I don't think money should be given for mitigation anyway. It's a safety concern, and that should be constructed as a safety concern. I have questioned many traffic impact studies, as I did this one, as I'm still doing this one. 2007 data, based upon 10 years, it was using the 2005 census numbers. Now we're using the 2020 census numbers. So the numbers versus the data, they're willing to use a 2007 study, but they're saying that our population is going to increase exponentially over the next few years to 115 or 20,000. Myrtle Point Road is 18 feet wide. The comprehensive plan states that roads that serve over 400 cars a day must be 20 feet wide, and that's based upon the ASHTO, which is the American Association of Highway and Transportation Officials. Does not comply with a comprehensive plan in that aspect again. There are approximately, on the plans, if you looked at them, 7 or 8 intersections going to be coming out of the different Myrtle Point sections onto county roads. Should be unacceptable, especially with the future expansion that's planned at Myrtle Point Park. Parks and Rec had a presentation that I attended the other night, and they talked about Myrtle Point already being a traffic problem and parking problem with the number of cars that's already coming down there, and that's before any future expansion. Real estate data. Mr. Mazza last time made a comment that the townhouses should be approved because people don't rent houses when they're over $1,800 a month. I'm a licensed realtor. I did my data just today. As of today, there were 40 current rentals, 1,800 plus. I only did 4 bedrooms, to be fair, since townhouses are 4 bedrooms. In the past only 2 years, 293 homes have been rented of 1,800 or above. At 4 bedrooms, not counting 3 bedrooms because there's a lot of fancy 3 bedrooms that are large and stuff. So there's plenty of rentals that are going to happen in the condos, in the townhouses. The condos, being a realtor, Wildwood's got the most condos. When you get over there trying to sell one of them, if the rent-to-own ratio is above a certain percentage, you can't get a VA or an FHA loan. And if a certain percentage haven't paid the HOA, that you have to provide the data to the lender, you can't get a loan. I had one last year fall through because of that. Townhouses, I don't care what's personally built. I just think it's too much, way too much for the area. A quick overview. There's no other reason why this is being done with the exception of money. I don't think we as a county, you as a board, anybody should strictly approve a project that is only for greed. Only for greed. It provides worse traffic, nothing positive. The developer has used terms like shift in the market, age in place, and I've sold hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of homes to various age groups and never heard anybody say, I'm sure hoping I'm gonna be in this house in 40 or 50 years. Millennials don't know where they're gonna live in 2 years, more or less 40 years, just because they're putting elevator shafts in. Just doesn't make any sense. And I'll close it there, take any questions if you have. All my data with the comp plan, subdivision ordinance, real estate data, it's all in the records. There's nothing made up there.
So. Anyone have any questions?
No.
Thank you.
Matt Hudson.
Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimonies, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay, if you would, your name and address, please.
Matthew Hudson, 23620. Matthew Hudson, 23620, Whispering Woodway, okay. California, Maryland. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say that I'm for the proposal.
Okay. Everybody's saying I'm going to ask you this question. I'm going to put you on the spot, okay? The people that are opposed, they give them reasons why. Why are you supporting it?
Okay, so my ex-wife actually worked for Curtis, worked for the realtor, and she also worked for Stanley Martin. I think the gentleman that she's a licensed realtor in Maryland, and I asked her what our property value would do. She said that it would go up. So, based on that, I'm for it. I don't see any problems with the traffic. I hope that, you know, if you deny it based on traffic, that you somehow limit Calvert from building over there.
That would be good. That would be good. That would be good if we could do that.
I like that.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, yes. She gave the testimony. Okay.
Greg Shields.
I just needed my time to.
Okay. Thank you. Christine Willett. Christy Willett. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and statements you may give with the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay, for the record, your name and address.
Krista Willett, 23662 Edgewood Way, California, Maryland.
Thank you.
I also do not have a speech prepared, but I do support the builder's plan. I think our neighborhood has kind of gone stagnant in growth. And I've been there 7 years. You know, not having a pool, I think, is not good for our property value. It's time for us to grow and move forward with the plan.
Okay. You were there before this developer took over?
No, actually, I was. Curtis was the developer.
Okay. Right. Anyone else have any questions?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oscar De Jesus.
Hello.
Hi there. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. For the record, your name and address, please.
My name is Oscar De Jesus, Jr.
Okay.
And I have been here just for a few days. I'm a new resident of Maryland, so I support Myrtle Point's view, But I, again, also, just like a couple of the previous people, don't have anything prepared because I'm just coming here. But from what I see, I'm coming from the state of California, which has one of the biggest highways and a lot of traffic. So to me, this is peaceful. This is open area, and it seems like it's growing. And with growth come change, and with change come diverse changes. Like I'm hearing the FDR, if I'm not mistaken, is opening up, which I think will give leeway to the streets that they're talking about. Again, I'm not real familiar with everything, so I don't have a lot of information to support it. But from what I see, it looks like it's growing, and I'm just in support of it because I'm becoming a new resident here, and I like the change. For me, it's a development and an opportunity, so that's why I'm here.
Okay, thank you, and welcome to Maryland.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. DeJesus, can you tell me what street you lived on again, for the record? Can you tell me what street you lived on?
It's off of Dwell, Berry, and Dewberry.
Dewberry, okay.
Dewberry.
Okay, we just couldn't make it out on the sheet here. That's good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Anyone else we can wishing to speak this evening? Seeing none, we'll close the public testimony. Mr. Lawmore.
May we sit up?
Sure,
here?
Please.
And for the record, I know we put it on last time. My name's Chris Longmore. I'm the attorney here with Curtis Development Corporation. Mr. Chairman, if we may, we do have some rebuttal that we'd like to present to the board. We intend to be brief. We think our presentation last time covered a lot of the issues that have been raised tonight, but we will address some of the specific concerns we think may be of interest to the board. I'm certainly here and available to answer any questions. Mr. Lenhart, our traffic engineer, and Mr. Mazza and Mr. Horner are here again this evening. Mr. Mudd had a prior travel plan. That's why he's not here tonight. When it got rescheduled, he could not be here, but the rest of our team is. And Mr. Lenhart would like to start, if possible, with some responses to the issues that have been raised about traffic within the public testimony.
Is Mr. Lenhart going to give testimony again?
He is, Mr.
Then I'll swear him in again, please. Mr. Lenhart, do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
And Mr. Chairman, Mr. Lenhart, with some of the issues that had already been raised last time, did prepare a written statement that will supplement his verbal testimony today. I'd like to present copies to the board and everyone at the table. I also have an extra copy or two for any of the folks in the audience that may like to have a copy. If I may do that, and I'll let Mike start.
Sure. Good evening. I would like to address a few of the statements that were made in the presentation this evening. The PowerPoint presentation.
Okay. Mr. Lenhart, before you get in, make sure we got the right number here for your... Mr. Lenhart, do you remember what our last submission was for him? His last
submission.
Yeah, the number we used. This is an updated version of what we had before?
It's actually a new summary based on some of the comments that were made at the last hearing and that were...
This will be your Exhibit 3.
Exhibit 3, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We'd ask that it be made part
of it. I just want to make sure we get that straight before we...
Thank you.
I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, that's fine. And I'll cover what's in that in a moment.
Okay.
I'd like to start just by addressing some of the statements that were made this evening in the presentation. The presentation falsely stated that this development has not provided any mitigation. This development, as we testified along with Mr. Groger, was studied intensely when it was originally approved. It provided mitigation including left turn lanes, Axel D-cell lanes at Route 4 Patuxent Boulevard, along with the traffic signal at 4 Patuxent Boulevard. It also included the construction of a southbound triple left, a third left turn lane on Route 4 at Route 235. And so there was substantial mitigation. It was found that those improvements mitigated this project. We did conduct and submitted with this application a traffic impact study that looked at the current proposal in relation to the prior approvals. And that was submitted to Mr. Groger. Mr. Groger reviewed it and agreed that it has a negligible impact and that the mitigation still stands, even with this proposal. Yet there was a proffer by the applicant to provide some additional funding toward the ultimate Route 4 right-of-way acquisition for the state highway widening projects. The presentation implied that, and we heard this at the last hearing as well, that these are oversized townhomes and therefore the ITE trip generation for townhomes shouldn't apply. A 22 to 2400 square foot townhome is not an oversized townhome. It may be down here, it may be on the larger size for a townhome, but it is not an oversized townhome. It fits well within the ITE data and the data that is used by the county and their zoning ordinance. So what we submitted tonight for your consideration is an additional memo dated October 11th. And what we're doing in this memo is we're addressing the changes in traffic along Myrtle Point Road and the safety, resulting safety along Myrtle Point Road. The approved plan had 57 single-family units with access only on Myrtle Point Road. For those 57 single-family units, you had to drive on Myrtle Point Road to get to them. They had as many as 15 private driveways on Myrtle Point Road. And as was testified tonight, there are no shoulders. It's a narrow roadway. With those 15 private driveways came the potential for on-street parking. People, you know, you're having a party, you're having guests. You don't have enough people, spaces in the driveway. Now you've got people parking along the shoulder of the roadway, which is really not sufficient for on-street parking. So the current plan eliminates those 57 homes and replaces them with 110 townhouse units. But those 110 townhouse units have only two access points on Myrtle Point Road. And the two groupings of units, one's 24 townhome units, which has access on the north side of Myrtle Point Road, and really those 24 townhomes have to drive on Myrtle Point Road. The 86 townhomes across the street have two access points, one on Myrtle Point, one on Patuxent Boulevard. And if you look at the site layout of the current proposal, those 86 townhomes, if they're heading out to Route 4, it's much more direct. It's closer to use the Patuxent Boulevard access out to Route 4, at which point you have a traffic signal if you want to go north on 4, so you have a safe traffic signal to help you be able to turn left. You also have an acceleration lane if you want to go south on Route 4. So those 86 townhomes, if they wanted to go out Myrtle Point, it's a longer route to get there, and they don't have the signal of the access lanes and the turn lanes. It's my opinion that the majority of those 86 townhomes, if not all of them, will use the Patuxent Boulevard access out to Route 4 and would have very little impact on Myrtle Point Road. So really, what you have then are the 24 townhomes. So we're taking 57 singles off of Myrtle with all the driveways, the potential for on-street parking, and the conflicts and safety issues that go with that. We're replacing it with 24 townhomes off of one access. And so that reduction in traffic actually reduces the traffic on Myrtle Point Road by 32 trips in the morning peak hour and 45 trips in the evening peak hour. And those are using those using county trip generation rates. Also, 57 single family units. There was testimony toward the end here that the code says if there's more than 400 trips per day generated by a development, that 20-foot lanes are required, or 20-foot roadways required. 57 single-family units would have generated 544 trips per day. The 24 townhomes will generate 140 trips per day. So it's significantly below the 400 units or 400 trips that was testified this evening. 140 trips per day with one access. With it eliminates the potential for on-street parking, it eliminates all the driveways and the points of conflicts associated with that. We believe it's a much safer scenario. And that's the exhibit that I gave you basically says that in the memo, and then there's three exhibits. Exhibit one is shows the approved plan with all of the single-family homes back off Myrtle Point Road. Exhibit two shows the proposed plan and the circulation, again, that makes Patuxent Boulevard a much more convenient access for those units. And then Exhibit 3 is just the trip generation comparison that I just quoted.
And Mr. Chairman, I know that at the last hearing I had Mr. Lenhart testify about both his education and credentials and experience within the field of traffic engineering. If the board would like to hear it again, we can. But I would note for the record that that was in the hearing last time. I don't know if the board has any need for that. Good. Thank you. Okay, thank you. That was the testimony we had from Mr. Lenhart relating to the traffic concerns that were raised. I had a couple of comments or rebuttal comments on some of the other statements that I'd like to make. And certainly anyone from our team is available to answer any questions. One of the things that was raised in the PowerPoint presentation during the public testimony related to the RLT zoning of Section 6. It is currently zoned RLT. The Lexington, I will say that I believe the testimony was inaccurate that was presented to this board about what the Lexington Park Development District Plan calls for in this area. It does call for rezoning the property into the RL zone. It has for the entire time that the plan has been in effect since last year. The plan is undergoing some revisions right now. I know Mr. Hunt is here, and I believe he will confirm this statement, that there is no intention by the Planning Commission, which has reviewed all the maps at this point, to in any way change it. The bottom line is, at this point, the Board of County Commissioners has adopted a Lexington Park Development District plan. It is a plan that is in place. There are amendments that are in process. But the plan that is in place right now clearly shows this area being rezoned as RL. And as I believe Mr. Barling is county attorney here previously, and I believe Mr. Weisskopf will support this. The current state of Maryland law is that a master plan has significant weight in any development that wants to occur within an area. It is not just a guide, it is something that we need to comply with. The plan is clear that it will be RL zoning. At the beginning of our presentation, or at the beginning of the hearing rather, Mr. Hunt addressed this issue last time and said that he was aware that it is RLT and that an appropriate vote, should the board decide to approve the project, would be for Section 6 only, to approve it conditioned upon it later being zoned RL prior to final site plan approval. And that would ensure that the proper zoning was zoned for that section. It is a condition that we believe is more than appropriate. And I'll proffer to you that at the point that this was originally proposed, it was thought by many within the county staff and within our team that the Lexington Park plan and all the rezoning would have been done by now. There's been some delays on that, as I know the board is aware. And my client is willing to run the risk that it may not be rezoned that for Section 6, and if it's not, they will not be able to get their final site plan approval. So on that one, we don't think there's any legal issue there. I do have, as I guess our exhibit number 4, a copy just to reiterate the point that I made. A copy of one of the maps in the back of the approved Lexington Park Development District plan approved last year that clearly shows this area being rezoned as RL and not RLT, despite the testimony of the contrary during public testimony. I have copies for the board, and I'd ask that be made as exhibit 4. One other point I'd like to make that I think was very misleading in one of the prior presentations was the comments about the change in density in sections 5 and 6 in the prior plan that was approved.
I don't want to. Let the board can take a look at this before we move forward.
Certainly. Okay. And while they're being passed around, I'll be happy to. The way that I think is easiest to view that is you can see the bridge going over the river and kind of follow that back to on Route 4. RL is in a tannish color there. I do have the entire Lexington Park Development District plan, and I think that is an adopted plan of the county that we don't need to present as an exhibit, but is an actual county plan. Mr. Weisskopf, do you agree that the Lexington Park Development District plan, I don't believe I need to introduce as an exhibit since it's an adopted plan. It's
right.
It's as if it's an ordinance. This is only one page from it for illustration purposes.
Okay. Is everybody okay? Does anybody have any questions on this before we move further?
Mm-hmm. So the entire neighborhood that was testified to as being RLT and that being the nature of the neighborhood, the adopted plan says that will be changed as RLT. The next step in the process will be to adopt the enacting text amendments and the zoning map as part of the Lexington Park Development Plan, which the county is in the process of doing. And I would submit that they have to do that or else they'll be inconsistent with the plan that they've adopted. So that's why my client's willing to run the risk of that rezoning. The second point I'd like to make in rebuttal that, again, I think was very misleading in one of the prior presentations was the comparison of density in sections 5 and 6 as now proposed versus what was proposed before. What they failed to mention was section 4 before had several lots that have now been moved over to the other sections because section 4 is now where the community center is going to be. My client has created a design to this community to move that community center more central to the Woods and Myrtle Point community. I think this board has heard over and over again the prior night and tonight that the community wants that amenity, that it's something that's very important to them. Certainly there is more units in sections 5 and 6 than in the prior one, but a lot of those units are not in section 4 now because that's where the community center is. We think it was misleading to present it in that way in the board. Should not let them do that. The most obvious example of that is in the exhibit number 3 that we handed around earlier. Mr. Lenhart's exhibit shows the prior approvals from 2011 and the current proposed plans for 2017 and exhibits 1 and 2 to that. And you can see where on exhibit 1 to our that is attached to our exhibit 3, the traffic memo that was presented tonight, there were some lots shown directly across from the main entrance of the current single family development. And now those lots will not be there. Instead, that'll be the pool and the community center, the parking for trailers for the development, as well as the daycare center that'll be provided for within that community center. I think that was a misleading point. We'd ask the board not to be fooled by that type of presentation. I do have some argument to make to the board about why I think we've met all the requirements. And I'd be happy to now start into that unless the board has any questions you want before we present our final arguments.
Go ahead.
Yeah. To be clear, this has to do with the presentation by Mr. Lenhart. Your traffic impact study, I just want to be clear, does it take into consideration your current proposal, your new proposal?
Sure. Mike, do you want to? I'll let Mr. Lenhart testify so we have a clear record since he's the one with the personal knowledge of that.
And could you explain how it does?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, your traffic impact study.
Yes.
I just want to be clear. Does it take into consideration your current proposal, your current proposal?
It does, yes. Yes, how does the current development proposal.
And how does it do that?
We looked at the prior approvals and the mitigation that was put in place by the prior approvals and the unit counts and the trip generation that was generated by that, and then we looked at the current proposal and comparing that to what was previously approved and how it impacts the prior approvals and the trip generation. And there was a negligible change in the results of that. It still mitigated the original approval, the original impacts. And Mr. Groger from Department of Public Works reviewed and concurred with that it's a negligible impact. Therefore, the approvals and mitigation still stand.
Yes, I got one. I just going back to the public comment about the Myrtle Point road width. Do you have any comments as opposed to what they were suggesting, that it was not wide enough?
Again, as I testified a few moments ago, I think that the current proposal reduces this development's impact to Myrtle Point Road by.
But they were suggesting that because of the volume that the road should be wider in their statements, and I didn't know if you had any comments associated with that.
The reduction
was like, 18 to 20? I believe Mr. Banneker made the comment.
18 to 20 feet. I mean, the county, the code states 20 feet.
Okay.
But as they testified, that's for 400 trips per day,
yes,
or more. This change is going to eliminate it. Current 57 single-family homes generate over 500 trips per day on that roadway, and the current proposal will reduce that to about 140 trips per day. Okay. So it cuts it by.
So your comma would be that the volume is much less.
It's much less, yes. Maybe a third.
The there was also a point brought out that the SHA rating on the Route 4 and the Patuxent Boulevard intersection is an F.
It is an F, yes. Okay. But this.
And we just need to elaborate on that, if you would, please.
Yes, it is an F. However, as the prior approvals and the prior mitigation, everything on record from this development going back to day one, found that the improvements that were required, the signal at 4 and Patuxent, the left turn lane, the axel decel lanes, and the triple left turn lane down at 235 mitigated this site's impact. And the zoning ordinance states that mitigation is what's required. You don't have to bring it back to a level of service D. So yes, it's an F. Everybody knows it's an F. It's largely because of the traffic that comes across the bridge in and out of the county. You've got one way in and one way out. But this development mitigates its impact with improvements that have already been built.
All right, that's all I have right now. That's all I have for Mr. Lenhart.
Thank you.
I don't have anything else for Mr. Lenhart, I'm sorry. Anyone else? Good. Okay.
So if I may, Mr. Chairman, I'll present our closing argument
well,
now.
What I'd like for you to do is address some of the other concerns that were brought up during the public testimony, okay? And I know that it was addressed at the meeting that we had a month ago. The water and sewer, can you touch on that for me a bit? As far as the infrastructure and
schools.
And the schools and things. They brought it up earlier again.
Okay. Well, sure. So. I will say that, and to the extent you need my client, either Mr. Horner or Mr. Mazza, to confirm this, the entire project was reviewed by the agencies, including MECOM and the other agencies. There was a comment made about it only being section 4 and 5. That was just the title of the first page of the plat, I believe. They can confirm that the entire project was reviewed by them and Mr. Horner. I'll proffer that he would testify to that unless you want to bring him up. So on those issues, we believe that it meets that. As to schools, there the way that the county has typically addressed that is having in place a growth policy. Essentially, when one is needed, the county has revoked its growth policy because it's not needed at this point. That is one of the standards in the concept site plan approval, as I know the board's aware, that it must meet that, and that was primarily relating to school seats. I will also provide as part of our response to that is that part of the record is the Planning Commission staff report. In fact, that's what was on the webpage as the staff report for tonight. And I'd asked at the beginning of last hearing, I asked to make sure that was part of this board's record tonight. That includes all the agency comments relating to all those, and all of them, without fail, stated that they recommended that it was appropriate for approval by the Planning Commission for concept site plan approval. There were none that suggested otherwise. So for all those reasons, we feel that that's been met. As to any water and sewer category issues, as the board may be aware, if there are any amendments needed for that, that comes after the concept site plan process, not before. That's the process the county follows. So that is really a non-issue at this point. This is somewhat part of closing argument as well, but I do take very significant exception to the statement that this is the last approval and Mr. Hunt doesn't have any role after this. There's one of the prior folks that testified about that. That just simply in the case. That's not the process the county follows. I think that was stated by cherry picking some language in one section. The section on concept site plans makes it very clear what the criteria is this board needs to follow as you sit in the shoes of the Planning Commission. There are the six factors that I'll address in my closing a little more detail. But as to adequate public facilities, to the extent that addresses your question, it is clear that what we need to prove tonight is that this project may meet adequate public facilities. It is also clear that one of the next steps in the process will be the final approval, which is done by Mr. Hunt in his role as planning director. And I believe he'll agree to that. I think the board already knows that. I think that was just a misstatement of the law as we have it in our county through these ordinances. So all of those things will be reviewed through that part of the process as well before a final approval can be given to this project. The concept site plan is the only time projects are before our Planning Commission, and now you sitting in their shoes. I know that some Planning Commission members have stated publicly they wish that wasn't the case. They wish that they had it later in the process, or they wish that they had applications more than once, but that simply isn't the law in our county. What needs to be approved now is the concept site plan. What gets approved in more detail later is done through staff according to the laws that have been adopted by our governing body, the Board of County Commissioners, and it's very clear. Until that changes, that's how the process is supposed to be followed.
I do have another question, but I think your client may have to answer this one. There was a question brought up about because of the change in the layouts of the single family versus the townhomes and stuff, that the erosion would be more as far as the development is concerned, and maybe your client can address that for us.
I can certainly have Tim or somebody step up and address that. While they're coming up, I will again note that Soil Conservation District is one of the agencies.
Oh, so, but the question came up. I'd like certainly to get an answer to that question.
Certainly.
Okay.
Certainly.
Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimonies, responses, and statements you may give be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And for the record, your name and address, please.
My name is Tim Horner, and my address is 131 Main Street, Suite 205, Prince Frederick, Maryland, 20678.
Mr. Horner, you testified last time, too, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So my question is, and you heard the testimonies this evening, we've had a lot, even from last month. But I think one of the other concerns is erosion. We're going from the set amount of single families to a larger amount of townhomes and condos. Okay, So if you could kind of give the board an overview of the erosion issue that you are facing, or if it's less or more.
Okay, in section six, our developable footprint in terms of clearing and in terms of grading is substantially less than it would be if we were to build the single family houses.
And explain why, please.
The footprint for the single family houses is much larger, and that would require a setback from the houses to be much larger. Footprint for clearing all the way through the backyards would require a lot more grading than the townhouses, which is a much narrower footprint, and the lots are much smaller as well.
Okay. I understand what you're saying, okay, but can you give me a comparison between the amount of homes and some sort of an idea how much clearing you would do there versus the amount of townhomes you would have? And if you can't answer, that's fine.
Yeah, that would be hard to calculate on an exact square foot basis.
I'm not looking for an exact, but
I don't have an exact number for
you. Okay.
And Mr. Chairman, just to highlight for the record, there was testimony at the last hearing that this plan compared to the prior one will have more forest conservation area included in it than the prior approved plan, as well as additional open space that will have less impervious surface.
Okay.
That's
a lot less clearing.
Yes.
So, okay. I think that answers my question. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you. Ms. Lomar, proceed.
Thank you. And again, members of the board, I know this isn't a position that you sit in frequently, but this is an appeal from a decision of the Planning Commission. Maryland law and our zoning ordinance provides to you all the powers of the Planning Commission in deciding the case tonight. It is your decision without any deference to their prior opinion. We obviously appealed that. We disagreed with their decision before. And what we'd ask the board to look at tonight are the six standards that the zoning ordinance requires you to look at. There are only six relating to a concept site plan. I know the board is aware of what they are, but I intend to address each of them in turn and highlight the evidence I believe is in the record that supports each of the six on behalf of my client. The first is whether or not the project is consistent with the applicable comprehensive plan. As I mentioned during our rebuttal testimony, the applicable plan in this area of the county is the 2016 Lexington Park Development District plan. The uses that are provided for within this development are allowed within the zoning categories within that plan, as well as the current zoning. The Lexington Park Development District plan, by its name and by its purpose, is the primary area within our county where the county has decided to direct its growth and new development. And that is what this project is. My clients purchased this property within a development district with the reasonable expectation that they would be able to develop it in accordance with the rules that are applicable to that development. And that's what this project is proposing to do. The Lexington Park Development District plan also calls for a mix of types of residential housing and different residential opportunities. That is what this development does within the development itself. As testified by my clients at the prior hearing, this will allow within this community itself different types of housing that will allow individuals, should they want to stay, to go through the different phases in life or different phases that they wish in different types of housing stock. There's also been testimony that the types of townhomes being provided are unique to this area and unique to the development district. It's going to provide a housing type that our Lexington Park Development District does not have now, and this is the area that the plan calls for the development to occur. I'd also remind the board that I submitted, as an example, but one of the maps within the Lexington Park Development District that shows that this is an area that's designed for this type of residential development, and therefore we believe it's clearly within the comprehensive plan and is consistent with it. The second standard is that the project may be served by adequate public facilities. We do not need to prove tonight that it meets all the criteria of Chapter 70 that comes with final site plan approval. Again, I believe legally that's clear within our ordinance for those that have read the ordinance as a whole. I will say for this project, we believe that there is clear evidence in the record that this project may meet those standards. There'll be public water and sewer. You've heard much testimony about the traffic and the traffic study that was presented. Submit to the board that the only expert testimony that was provided in any of the hearings was that of Mr. Lenhart and Mr. Groger in his role as DPW. Neither of them provided any concerns with the traffic in this. All of them said that the traffic meets all the applicable requirements. There is no evidence from any of the agencies or from anyone with an expertise in traffic that this will not meet the required traffic requirements. I would highlight Mr. Lenhart's testimony, his previous report, and the supplemental memorandum that we gave you today. And again, I'd ask the board to consider Mr. Groger's testimony from the last hearing. As I mentioned before, this project will still be subject to final site plan approval where adequate public facilities will be further evaluated and it will need to meet all those standards at that time. I would also like to highlight, as I mentioned previously, but just so the record is clear, the Planning Commission staff report included comments from the St. Mary's County Health Department, MedCom, Soil Conservation District, the Department of Public Works and Transportation, and the State Highway Administration. There were no negative comments and none that suggested that concept site plan approval should not be granted as part of this application. So for all those reasons, we think that it's clear that my client has met the burden and far exceeded that their project may be served by adequate public facilities. The third of the six requirements is that it be consistent with the county's annual growth policy. There is none in effect, and I believe county staff and everyone agrees that that is therefore not applicable because the county has revoked that policy. The fourth criteria is that the project will promote the health, safety, and welfare of the general public. The current proposal, we believe, meets all current codes and ordinances as my clients and their experts have testified to. We believe the design is consistent with the surrounding area. There was testimony at the last hearing of much of the design, including, as I mentioned before, that there will be more forest conservation areas than the prior plan that was approved. There will be more open space, that there is buffering of trees around much of the proposed development, as you can see from the site plan that is part of the record, as well as the exhibits to Mr. Lenhart's memo that we provided to you today, that much of the that there will be more forest if this is approved than if the prior plan were to go forward. I believe I counted 47 different stormwater management devices that will manage the stormwater from this, and again, it met all requirements to go forward a concept site plan. As set forth in the comments in the Planning Commission staff report. There are also, there's testimony before about a drainage system within the units to provide for it. The board may remember that. I know it's been a month ago. We believe that that promotes public safety and welfare. And there is also the potential for elevators in the units, as we mentioned, which we think can be a safety issue for different individuals, and we think it's a nice option for many people to have, and there's not many housing types within our community and townhomes that have that available at this point. The fifth standard that we need to meet is that there is adequately developed recreational and other community amenities. I've sat in front of the Planning Commission in front of you before arguing about this. I can't remember a project that has ones that are as complete as the ones that are being proposed, that are as functional. The pool that was proposed is not a small community pool, as was testified to. They're building one that will meet many of the needs to it and building a very high quality one. The clubhouse that will be built is a significant one. The proposal to have a daycare where the homeowners association will be able to use a community clubhouse that generally doesn't get used during the work days, to allow within this community itself a daycare center that will provide that need for young families. As many of you know, I have kids. That's a big concern for young parents, and that is a big amenity that most communities do not have within it. And we think it's a very creative idea and one that should be applauded. There are also the boat storage and other facilities that will be provided for in this community. As the, I'm sure the board is aware, that's a recreational activity that many in our community enjoy, and camping as well. Having those type of storage spaces within a community like that, that will allow it to be stored in that location at the back of the community amenity facility and not along the roadways, is something that we think is a very nice community amenity. And there were also tot lots that were testified to that will be part of it. So we believe there are more than enough adequately developed recreational and other community amenities. And then the final of the six criteria is that the project be consistent with countywide design objectives. And I would draw your attention, it's chapters 62.5 and 62.3 of the zoning ordinance. And those are the ones that talk about making sure that the design allows for breaks in the design of the different units within the townhomes. The elevations that were provided to you show that. I think the elevations that were provided within the plans and within our PowerPoint showing you that it is a very high quality design as is called for within our county design standards, both on the general ones and the 62.5 that are called for in townhouse and single family or multifamily attached. And it calls for different colors and different materials. And again, our PowerPoint demonstrates that that'll be the case. And we believe that it will be compatible with the surrounding area, particularly given that our proposal is adding more forest conservation. We'll have increased acreage that is not developed, as was testified to before at our last hearing. I believe it was 3 acres, if I remember correctly. So for all those reasons, we believe that this design is consistent with it. There were townhomes in the other project. This is being redesigned based on market conditions and on what my client believes will be the most impactful to the community. And we believe that this is one of those projects that is a very significant upgrade in providing housing types that our community does not have. I know this board sits through a lot of public hearings, so do I. I can't remember one where there's been so much support for a project from people that are going to live right next door to it. You can recall from the last hearing night and tonight that there is a lot of support within the community. There are a lot of people that live there and live there every day that like this project, and we think that that should be included in this board's consideration. In short, we believe that my client has met all of the six criteria that they are required to prove in order to get concept site plan approval. Respectfully, I don't think there is any relevant or weighted evidence within the record that would support a denial on this. And we would ask that the board consider all the evidence that is before you, consider the folks that have testified that have expertise in the areas that they've talked about, and give weight to that evidence. And we'd ask that you approve the concept site plan as it's presented with the condition for section 6 again. And we agree that condition will need to be there, that before final site plan approval, that would need to be rezoned to a rezoning category that would allow for that development, specifically RL zoning. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lomar. Is there any questions for Mr. Lomar, Mr. Green?
I think one area that may not have been addressed totally, and I think you did it to some degree when you talked about forest restoration, and that is the buffering around the surrounding neighborhood. If you can address that a little bit more as far as what buffering or debuffering around the surrounding neighborhood.
Sure, and I can have, if it's appropriate, I'll let Mr. Horner pick up that since I do. Yeah, that was, I'm handing Mr. Horner the PowerPoint presentation that we presented last time, which is in the record.
Okay, our engineer, Pat Mudd, previously discussed in the last meeting the development footprint and open space calculations over the course of three different plans. The first was the PF Summers plan from 2011, our revisions in 2014, and then our plan that we're proposing today. And the open space provided in the 2011 proposal was 38.49 acres and forest conservation areas of 22.19. The open space increased from 38.49 to 54, just over 54 in 2014. And in 2017, our plan increased open space to 57, so an additional 3 acres, and from 38.49 in 2011 to 57.4 today. And our forest conservation areas go from 22.19 in 2011 to 40.32 today. So substantial increases.
I see, okay. All right.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, good.
Any other questions?
When you were in the adequate public facility area, you were quoting the sewer and water and everything as it came through the tech process. What seems to be missing is schools. Is it a hole in the system that they really don't provide a written evaluation, or am I missing something there?
I don't know if Mr. Hunt would care, since that's a county policy. My understanding is that the county, and from my experience, is that schools have certainly been an issue within the county in the past. They've been an issue with this project before Curtis Development took it over, when there were no school seats in development. School seats were being handed out to projects on a yearly basis. That caused the county, when that need was present, to adopt their annual growth policy to allow for growth to occur in a way that could be managed within the school systems, was one of the primary reasons for that, to allow phasing within projects that had not been allowed. That was revoked when bluntly, there has not been as much residential development within our county in the last few years. Certainly, that is something that the county, I know, looks at and monitors. It's something that by adopting those policies and revoking them at certain times, I believe the county commissioners have done. Development always brings new students in schools when you have a growing community. You heard the census reports. And I don't have the census in front of me, but a lot of that growth, I think, is accurate. But that's how I understand the county has dealt with it over the years, and at this point they've suspended that policy because they don't see that the amount of residential development that's being done within our county at this point requires those type of restrictions at this point. And Mr. Hunt, I don't know if I'm misstating that or not.
Mr. Hunt, if you don't mind, come up and take a seat or take the mic, either way. But let me swear you in, please. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Longmore did a very good explanation of the growth policy with relation to schools. It was the one adequate public facility that could not be put off when growth was so high that school seats weren't available. Now that situation, as was described, is no longer present, so the annual growth policy has been revoked. When a residential development comes through our office, our capital facilities planner does look at the availability of school seats, and of course finds within the last few years that there are no deficits. So it's not a factor that's going to limit the development of the residential type units in this project.
And that's at all three types of schools, the elementary, yes, the all middle, the way and through. The high. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
And I will just state for the record, since there was testimony previously in the hearing, it's not directly related to this project, but my client did donate a very significant school site on St. Andrews Church Road to the county for future development of schools.
That's not part of this.
Right.
Mr. Longman, that's good that it does that. We appreciate that, but it's not part of the application tonight.
Right.
Okay. Mr. Hunt, I do have one other question for you, though, just so everyone here understands. This is a concept site plan.
Yes, sir.
That we are reviewing this evening. And anything beyond that comes to you and your staff for final approval, no matter what it is.
Am I correct in what I'm saying?
Well, yes, I think I do. Okay. It does, the plan that's approved tonight has to meet all the requirements for major site plan review. And upon doing that, then the director verifies that all the criteria have been met, all the regulations have been satisfied, and then signs off for the final approval of the plan.
Okay. And sitting here, you've sat here for the two nights that we've been here, we have six different requirements that the applicant has to meet to get through this portion of it. And one of them is really not applicable to that. And that would be the number three, which is consistent with the growth policy. Would you agree with that?
Mostly, sir, but there is the one thing that, in addition to the growth policy not being applicable, but as Mr. Longmore has stressed before the board tonight and at the previous hearing, as I recall, is that a finding of adequate public facilities may be made by this board has to be demonstrated at final site plan approval. So any questions that the agencies may have deferred to that final approval has to be verified by those agencies. For instance, there will be sewage generated, of course. The sewage treatment plant does have adequate capacity at the concept site plan level, but before final site plan approval, I would want to verify that that is indeed the case at the time, because there could be some delay between tonight's hearing and when the final does go through. So that would be one, that's just an example of the kind of additional review that has to be undertaken. So with that minor alteration of how the chairman said it, I would say yes.
Okay. So the flow of gallons could change between now and then.
Well,
and they would have to get the approval for that then.
There would have to be verification from Metcom that at the time the units come online, there is adequate EDUs available at the sewage treatment plant for that amount of sewage that's going to be approved. There won't be a problem. Had there been a problem or the suspicion of a problem, it wouldn't have gotten this far without the developer having to make some kind of mitigation or do some kind of phasing that would make sure that didn't take place. Okay. I was just throwing that as an example of an extra detailed step that has to be in to go along with what Mr. Longmore said. Adequate public facilities may be found to be adequate tonight, but at some point they have to be actually deemed to be present for the development to actually take place.
Okay.
And sewage was just the easiest one that I could come up with, because right. Obviously if you don't have sewage disposal, you can't build a house.
Correct. Okay. Anybody have any questions for Mr. Hunt while he's up here?
No.
Okay. Thank you, sir. All right. Anything else, Mr. Longmore?
I think that concludes our presentation, unless the board has any further questions.
Any questions from Mr. Longmore? Okay, thank you. Hi, comments? Discussions?
I think that you met the standards for concept approval. I think the best statement I heard out of two nights sitting here was about the traffic, was that the bridge and that intersection, I don't think this is going to make any difference. I think they both need to be improved, and everybody knows that. I don't think this is going to, I'm sure it's going to add extra traffic, but it's not going to make any difference.
Well, I see us. We're sitting here, it's the concept site plan, very clearly laid out in the comprehensive, as Mr. Longmore has pointed out, the 6 points. There have been points brought up by the public, but I would also suggest to them that is not in the board's realm for this decision, and if they want to change it, then unfortunately they have to follow another avenue back through the commissioners. But I am supportive of what I see here.
Okay.
John,
have no comment.
Okay. Mr. Payne?
No.
Okay. All right. So I also in agreement that I believe that the applicant at this point in time in the juncture of the planning, the concept part of it has met just that, the concept, okay? When it comes to the traffic, I think Mr. Lenhart did a fantastic job the second go-around as well, explaining the traffic, the concepts there, the avenues of which the, especially Section 6, has not going to affect one of the major roads that the concern came up with tonight, especially with the second exit out of there. The schools and the water and the sewer, I think Mr. Hunt has that well under control there, especially when it comes to the final, because he has other people giving him expert opinions or testimony to him to support what he needs to do to approve it at the final stages there. The safety and the health and the welfare, I think the design here, especially when it comes to open areas, the buffers, the forest conservation means a lot, okay? And the way they were able to change it and increase it by 20 plus acres, I think is what it was. I may be off a little bit on my numbers, but
yeah, 20 acres.
The that means a lot when it comes to developments, especially, you know, they're not changing a lot of the development area, and it's keeping it buffered from the existing pieces that are there. Okay, and I think that was a lot of the concern there too, is that, you know, the single families versus the townhomes and stuff like that. If we have the forest conservation, we have the buffer areas and the open areas to separate those. I think that means a lot too. The recreational facilities. I don't know of any places that I can recall right now that has or that will, you know, that supports the community with a pool, a clubhouse, the playgrounds, daycares, things of that nature. I think it's a plus for the development to even put that in there, okay? The pool and the clubhouse and the playgrounds, you know, but when you propose, you know, storage items, there are storage areas and daycares, I think that's, Mr. Longwood touched really heavy on that one. I don't have that problem anymore, okay? My daycare days are over with. But it's good that they can support the area with that. And then the designs, I guess Mr. Hunt and his team will play a big part in the designs of these units and stuff to make them attractive. So in saying that, I think that they have met the basic requirements for the concept site plan. So
I also want to add that the fact that there would be less grading, that this concept here would allow for less grading, less movement of the earth, less pollution, and plus that it complies with the requirements of the Lexington Park Development District Master Plan as well as the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Regulation. So it does what it's supposed to do.
Okay. All right. I think, any other discussion?
The Planning Commission denied it because they did not meet all the requirements. We're saying they have met all the requirements.
I think so. There's they've met five out of the six, and one of them is not applicable at this point.
And that's the zoning one.
That's the number three, the zoning one, yep.
It's not applicable because of
the growth policy has been rescinded.
Okay.
According to Mr. Hart. Okay. So that piece doesn't apply. But if they don't meet the requirements when they go for the final, if it takes 2 years to get to a final and things change in the county, with Mr. Hunt used sewer, I'll use school. Okay,
that for some reason or other the school seats fill up prior to them getting the final, they wouldn't be allowed to get the final until there were more seats available. So that would be, that falls under, based on number two, but following the number three as well.
We can't think of what the Planning Commission was thinking when they use the same logic.
I don't know. I can't think for them. But this is the way I see it. This is what I, you know, just with the evidence that was presented to us, this is the way I see it. They have a long ways to go from this point. They're just at a concept, okay? The other thing, too, is that the commissioners may not change the zoning from the RLT to RL. They may not change that. If they don't change that, then Section 6 doesn't even come into play except for the original design back then. So that's, I think everything's in position to allow the concept to go through. But when it gets further down the road, when it gets into the final pieces of this, the biggest thing is if the commissioners don't change the zoning. So if they don't, 86 of those townhomes go away in Section 6. So it goes back to the single families then.
Respectfully, there's only 24.
I'm sorry, 24. I used the wrong. 24. Yeah, sorry. Okay, so that change that goes back. So that's one key element that they have to have. Okay, and the other key element is just like Mr. Hunt said. You know, once they get to a point, it could be some time down the road. If they don't meet, the sewer could be a big issue. If that changes, the gallons change on that, and we don't have enough capacity where it's got to go to Metcom, then they can't approve it until something else is done at Metcom to accept that. The, you know, the school seating, if they get to a point where the school seats aren't available, they can't proceed. And they have those numbers readily available, I'm going to say, pretty often. Right, Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, if something goes wrong, if they change, you know, force conservation or things of that nature where something changes and there's a safety issue or there's a welfare issue or things of that nature, those things change down the road as design gets further. And that's when it falls in Mr. Hunt's lap. With the soil conservation folks, you know, through the TEC process. Those guys respond to land use with the information they need to approve this at the final Okay. So, and I agree, I don't know what they were thinking of, or there was more information that was received here. There was more questions that this board asked to get that more information out to put me in a place where I'm fine with what we have in front of us. Anything else?
Well, I think that you pretty much covered it. It's a lot of checks and balances in the system from concept to final approval. So I wouldn't know why anyone would say that the concept site plan hasn't, the elements haven't been met.
Right.
That's my take on it.
I agree. Okay. Anything else? Any other comments? Then I'm open for a motion, and I'd like for whoever makes the motion, let's see what the motion is going to be first.
Well, I'll try to stumble through it.
Okay.
In the case of 8-17-04 Woods at Myrtle Point, sections 2, 4, 5, and 6, the concept site plan be approved with the condition that the RL zoning is approved for Section 6 prior to final approval. Did I get close to what we're looking for?
I believe then that condition will be on section 6 only, is that? Because that's the only one that has that, is that correct? Thank you.
Yes.
I'll second that motion.
Have a motion and a second. We'll start with Mr. Medinsky.
Yes.
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 Yes. Mr. Longmore, as you can hear, the board has unanimously supported the applicant's request this evening. Okay? An order reflecting the board's decision will be prepared by staff and signed by the board within 30 days. A 30-day period followed from the date the order is signed, during which time any aggrieved party may appeal this board's decision in circuit court. Any action taken during that time will be at your own risk, and we'll send you a copy of the order once we've signed it.
Thank okay? you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a nice night.
Can we get 10 minutes?
Yep. Can we take a 10-minute break, and then we'll come back? That will be a good time for you all to clear it. We're back in session. We have a couple of things to get done. First of all, the minutes. Everyone have a chance to read the new minutes, okay? The first set of minutes had all the had more information than it's normally in it, okay? So the only thing we did was what was required for the minutes. It got changed. So any additions, corrections, or deletions to the?
No. I make a motion to approve the minutes.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you. And we have one. This was the case that was referred to us from Mr. Upton. Well, he sat in on us from Mr. Upton. He sat in on the case that night. Mr. Spaulding couldn't do it. And that was the AmeriCo Real Estate Company, the U-Haul. Mm-hmm. And we voted to reverse the decision. We had three voting for that to reverse the decision and two voted against it, okay? I just need the approval to sign it.
I'll make a motion to sign the order.
Have a motion?
Second.
And second, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thanks. Anything else good for the order? Our next meeting is November 9th.
What's that look like?
It's only one case so far.
Okay.
Probably won't be any more. Critical area variance.
All right. Then a motion for adjournment?
No
objection.
Motion.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.